One. Recording in progress. Good morning, Yana Ilyanova. So happy to have you. How are you doing?
Good morning, Gordon. I'm all well. Already busy since the early morning in preparation. We have less than 2.5 weeks left, and we have a great amount of international people attending us, so everything should be flawless. So we're all fired up.
Well, you already jumped the topic, but we'll go with it. So what we're talking about is the Future Innovation Summit, correct?
Yes.
Fantastic. And this is the summit you and other esteemed parties that we'll get into are organizing. And where is it and when is it?
So the Future Innovation Summit will be held in Dubai on 13th and 14th of October. It will be in a big and wonderful place called Intercontinental Hotel in Dubai mm-hmm. Festival City. So on 13th and 14th, we have panels, we have workshops, and on 14th in the evening, we will hold a gala dinner with also some awards and with a great show that will be digitally displayed as well as like normally traditionally shown.
Fantastic. So this is great. So we'll get into details about the summit shortly, but I want to give the audience a chance to get to know you. Yana was instrumental in helping me this year when I came to Dubai, just making some key introductions. It was very sweet, very supportive, very connected, I might add. I don't know if you remember this, but you actually helped me set up a boat or a yacht, like the first yacht trip that I think started all of these other yacht adventures. So you seem to be the woman about town. Can you tell us a little bit about yourself, even before Dubai? Like, where are you from? What did you do? How did you get here? And give us a chance to get to know you. Please.
I was born and raised in Russia, actually in the Soviet Union, yet. Mm-hmm. At that time, yeah. Then it turned into a Russian Federation. So I grew up there. I have a bachelor degree from the Russian University. So my first degree is actually in law. I'm a lawyer by my first degree, a civil lawyer, but I did not really practice a lot. Somehow it happened that straight away I started to work for physical trading, agricultural commodities, but more like from the business developing perspective, not really like a counsel or anything like that. So then I moved to Moscow. Once I graduated from my city, from Siberian University, I moved to Moscow. But shortly after, I was lucky and I found a job actually in Switzerland. And I moved to Switzerland, I moved to Zurich in 2004 in September. And then I changed my job as well, but it was always in commodities, in physical commodities trading. I was actually responsible for Russian agricultural product, you know, to purchase and to deliver to various countries. So the headquarters was in Switzerland and Zurich. Then it was this big famous crisis of 2008, when unfortunately my visa was not extended and I had to go back to Moscow. Then I worked for the micro-lending company, actually Russian American fund. But then I decided to get my degree somewhere abroad. And actually I was thinking about master program or MBA, but I was not sure where exactly. And by the time I passed my exams, like GMAT and IELTS, and I have all this confirmed, I received a job offer from London. So the puzzle went very smoothly, very nicely. So in September 2010, I moved to London. I was working full time. I was doing my MBA part time. It was rather challenging, but it was great. And then in 2013, I graduated. I hold a master MBA degree from the University of Wales, but the campus is in London. And
I heard that, but it's okay. Go ahead.
Stayed there for 8 years. So I worked there. I got various degrees around project management. I got a degree, another degree, like a qualification from the Oxford University in blockchain, blockchain course at Oxford University with Professor David. And I also got my second nationality, British passport. And then I decided to move somewhere else. And I came to Dubai with my family in 2018 in August. So now it's a little bit more than 3 years.
Amazing. And
since that time, since I got my qualification in the UK in blockchain, I actually started to get more involved more and more in the space of technology. And my last job, for example, in London, was in online gaming and gambling. And I also was helping some startups from Russia, from Ukraine, also to raise funds in London, and London or UK, yeah? And that's how I really got into this technology sector, again, from the position of business development. And I saw what huge potential it is. You're not really limited. So the sky is the limit, and this, all these 8 billion people are there, you know, almost waiting for you and ready to collaborate with you. And you can be any place you want. You can work remotely. And it's just such a, you know, breakthrough. It was just such a breakthrough for me. So I focused on technology. I focused on blockchain initially. Blockchain, yes, a little bit of cryptocurrency, various platform exchanges around that. But my passion and my interest was always more into some a little bit more valuable application, in my opinion. So for example, I was always fascinated by, let's say, agriculture, yeah? And I worked in this field for a while, and actually I was writing my thesis and preparing to defend my PhD in the economics of agriculture. And I saw the practical implementation of technologies such as big data, artificial intelligence and blockchain and so on, IoT, how they can benefit. This is one of the most traditional but so valuable sector, you know, of economy in our lives. If you know, more than 40% of population of the world are somehow related to agriculture. And we all eat, and we all drink, and we all need, you know, water, and we all need food. No matter what, yes, we cannot, you know, stay without this. So then I decided, yes, I defended my PhD last year during COVID. I was supposed to defend it a bit earlier, but for the COVID, everything was postponed. But luckily, I did it 22nd of October last year in Russia. I got my PhD in the economics of agriculture. And so now, let's say for more than 5 years, I am involved in various types of technology from the business development perspective, everything connected to strategy, marketing, communication to media, communication to investors, you know, communities around this. Like for now, because I'm based in the Middle East in Dubai, I'm targeting people who are outside but would like to come to the Middle East, show their product, you know, brand awareness, sell it, raise funds, have a strategic partnership here, and vice versa. Companies from here or investors from here who are looking at other markets, let's say former Russia, former Soviet Union, like Russia, Ukraine, and Kazakhstan, Europe. I don't really target United States. I have, of course, I come across, but it's a little bit still far away, a little bit different, challenging, time difference, and for now, I'm satisfied with Europe, Middle East, and ex-Soviet Union region.
That's a pretty good reason. Region, you're not lacking in ambition by covering all those. That's a fantastic. You have quite the background. I didn't even know all that about you, but it's good that we're doing this. So I had a chance to learn.
Matryoshka, you know, you start off and you can another layer, and it's another layer. So yes, and there are still more layers to go.
We'll do episode 2 of the show. we'll do the full intelligence briefing. Okay, so now let's bring us up to sort of the current moment, which is you're involved. You're putting together this Future Innovation Summit. How did you connect up with, and you'll say the name properly, the Sheikh's office? How did you start your collaboration, and how did it lead to this?
For the last couple of years, I was heavily involved in road shows and events, and I like it. I like communication, I like meeting various people. I like to be, you know, like seen, let's say. I am not a person from the back office. When it's needed, yes, but that is not my favorite, you know, type of job to be sitting in the back office, not just my personality. So I decided not to fight my personality, but actually enhance the traits and qualities I think I have, and I could, you know, better develop them. So I was involved in Davos during the World Economic Summit last year in 2020, I partnered with some companies and we organized actually 5 events at Davos. Mm-hmm. Before and later, I partnered also with another company that worked closely with the Prince Albert from Monaco, and they were organizing events around sustainability and agriculture, as well as a part of this agricultural solution, you know, water, recycling, green energies, like all the sustainability and agriculture. So it mm-hmm. actually just hit, you know, my interest and my passion. And then at one of the such events, actually I got introduced to the His Highness office. Then mm-hmm. I invited them also to be our guest of honors and speakers at CC Forum here in Dubai. Mm-hmm. And then we continued communication. And then by the end of August this year, the office approached me and asked me to help them with the organization of the summit and to be the head of the project. And I gratefully accepted. That was also very close to my vision. Mm-hmm. I also wanted to talk about serious valuable technologies, very strong use cases. I wanted to have more decision makers, policy makers, you know, representatives of various regulatory authorities. And my vision is just, you know, was similar to the vision of His Highness Sheikh Saker Al-Qassimi office and the chairman Adnan. So we spoke and we understood that yes, we look at this similarly, and we decided to combine our efforts and prepare the summit.
That's fantastic. So good background. So this is obviously the sort of summit or conference or expo season in Dubai right now. We got Expo 2020, and since I got here 3 weeks ago, even before all that, the invitations have been nonstop. I've had to not attend many just so I don't get fat from eating all the food and drinking all the beverages. But the Future Innovation Summit strikes me as somewhat different from the ones I've been exposed to so far. The ones I've seen so far have been sort of crypto blockchain oriented. This seems much more innovation, much more technology, much more government oriented. Can you explore the themes behind the summit in a little bit more depth and maybe integrate that with who will be attending, who will be speaking, and then the expected audience?
Yeah, that's correct. We think that we are different. Initially, straight away, we decided to differentiate and have it more like governmental level and local government level, because I saw it myself and His Highness Sheikh and the office also noticed that for all these tons of events, we are very lucky in Dubai. We are really never bored. Everything is just, you know, happening very nicely around us. But we see the majority are expats and they are running around and having, you know, events and parties, but it's mostly, yes, about crypto exchanges, all this new young generation and with the peer-to-peer events. So we decided that we will be different because we have an admin resource, what is the mm-hmm. office of His Highness. So mm-hmm. we have a possibility to invite, and we invited, and luckily majority of highly ranked officials accepted the invitation. So we are having like very, very senior level representatives from local governments, from local authorities, from various initiatives from Dubai, Abu Dhabi, Sharjah. We're also now waiting for the acceptance also from Bahrain, for example, from Central Bank of Bahrain. So we will have either His Excellency as guest of honors or even as speakers, for example, mm-hmm. from Ministry of Education, Healthcare, Policymaker of Aviation. We will have a panel actually devoted to aviation of tomorrow. So we will be speaking, yes, quite a lot about education. We collaborate with universities. We invited also the students to listen to. And we will have a lot of local representatives from government and from big companies such as PwC Middle East, DHL Middle East preliminary confirmed, and so on, DIFC, DMCC. But we will also have international guests that are already either in the region or would like to come to the region, have really strong intentions, you know, about the region. we have a diverse crowd. I mean, we have, yes, male and female, I would say almost equally represented, but not 50-50, but almost. We will have students, as I said, we will have academics from the universities, and we will have practical people, IT people, you know, or lawyers who write some laws, and or IP people, or IT people who provide some solutions. But mm-hmm. we will have also governmental people who will be talking about vision, mission, and policy and legal frameworks in various sectors in the OIE. Mm-hmm. So I think that's why it's different, because we have really such, I would say, guests of honors and speakers of very high level who can guide us and explain us what's happening in the OIE and mm-hmm. what's the, you know, the next initiatives are coming and what is are the changes that, for example, will be soon and can guide us and deliver us the vision and the policy.
So let's drill, that makes a lot of sense. So let's drill in on that a little bit. The key term, I think, in the title is innovation. Can you maybe expand on that? What does innovation mean to you, to His Highness's office? What is the role of the innovation for the region? Why is this I mean, obviously innovation matters in general, but why is it such a specific, strong interest with His Highness's office, with you and with this region?
In my opinion, Dubai, the OIE in general, and Dubai in particular, is a really amazing example of how quickly and how greatly the country can develop.
Sure.
And okay, it started with oil. Yes, there were pearl divers, you know, Bedouins, and then oil was discovered, and it started with oil. But it's great that the country has the vision to diversify. Initially, I would say that Dubai was always like perceived as a place of tourism and entertainment and the biggest building and the, I don't know, the longest bridge and this and that and whatever. But now the vision has changed and it's really going very much into innovation. So for me, like I really like the example of Singapore, and mm-hmm. I read a lot of books of Lee Kuan Yew and the way how he really developed Singapore from a very ordinary place with 2 million people barely speaking, you know, English. And 30 years later, it was just like a miracle country, so safe, so great, so well advanced. And they had no resources. They only had the desire to prevail. And, you know, that they're very wise governance. And so Lee Kuan Yew, he focused on knowledge, on technology, on, you know, cutting edge skills. So Dubai for me is now like Singapore of the Middle East, Dubai and the UAE. So they really move aside from entertainment and oil production. And there are so many industries now that they develop, starting from technology to sport, to culture, you know, so many theaters are opening here and galleries and the Festival of Literature. And in terms of sport, you have, they build now this, the longest slope, so you can do actually international competition all the year around, you know, and tennis competitions are here, like world level mm-hmm. championships and cycling as well. Just these roads are building just everywhere, left and right. And the same is about innovation and science from school, from nursery. Actually, they already have this program, thanks to KHGA, about science. They already, you know, my son who is five, will be five soon, but from mm-hmm. the age of 2-3, they already, you know, start to bring them into science and more, what is interesting, into sustainability, into, you know, taking care of nature, into, you know, recycling. From the baby age, they really focus kids on this. And I think this is a great example for the country, for raising generations in this way, through education, sure. through delivering skills, and through careful, relation to nature. That's very important.
That was a great and expansive answer. And I love the Lee Kuan Yew reference from Singapore. I think that's very trenchant, very, very observant. So I think we'll sort of begin to wrap this up, but if people want to learn more about the summit, if they want to get involved, if they want to attend, if they just, like I do, appreciate the spirit of what you're looking to accomplish and want to get a sense for it? What are their steps? How do they reach out? Website, contact, all that other good stuff.
We have social media. We have Facebook, LinkedIn page, Instagram as well. We are not, you know, very heavily posting there. It's actually not our priority just to go all over on social media. So for us, the main source is a website. It's www.dfisx.com. DFISX.com, but maybe you can write it down somewhere.
Yes, we will have show notes, but it's good to hear it also. So yes, go ahead.
But otherwise, yeah, feel free also to reach me, and I'm available for any type of communication, calls, and visits to the office, and whatever means of communication people prefer. So we have like very, very strong, I would say, agenda now with the speakers, but there is still availability for participants because we have startup pitches. And in between these panels, we will have 15 minutes allocated just, you know, to companies to pitch their product. And we will have a competition. We have this finance office who will be, you know, choosing like the best three projects and also giving them awards and other support. And we will have also like representatives from governmental institutions. They will be also looking for certain technologies in certain companies. So they will be also looking for themselves, you know, and listening to these projects. So then we have also exhibition hall. So you can have a place, rent a stand, put your labs and make maybe something else that would really attract attention of visitors. We will have media support as well, local media, international media, gala dinner. Actually, people who would like to participate also at gala dinner, they can also co-sponsor, and we will give them a possibility to show their video, a short video, maybe 1 minute video, just in front of 350 VIP guests.
Amazing. But this sounds exciting. Oh, go ahead, please.
No, there's also a possibility to make a private party or private lounge or private announcement also like under umbrella of our event. For example, you don't want to have a stand, but you want to have more like a private, you know, VIP room, what is called Majlis here, and just invite, you know, like particular people, particular media. You can also like give the space and make arrangements, or on 13th in the evening, because we don't organize anything on 13th, we only have gala dinner on 14th. So on 13th, some of the companies, they in the hotel, they will make their own cocktail receptions, and they will, you know, invite their guests, our guests, and make some announcements for their moving to Dubai, for the launch of new product, you know, for like successful sales done or pre-sale started. So this also can be an option.
It's going to be a busy few days, and I'm happy that I'm going to be there. It sounds fantastic. It sounds like a good allocation of time. Perfect. All right, Yana, this has been fantastic. I really appreciate your time. I really appreciate the effort you're evidently putting into this. I think it's a very clever idea. I think it's something new in Dubai. And my invisible hat, I take it off to you. And
hope to exceed your expectations.
I'm sure it'll be fantastic. All right, very good. Thank you, everyone. Appreciate